Friends of Calvary, we are truly pleased to see you here today as we lift up the name of Jesus together. There is a communication card in your bulletin. If you would please fill that out, you can drop it in the offering box at the back of the sanctuary as you leave today. This does help us know who's here, what needs you might have, how we might pray for you, etc. So if you would fill that out for us, we would appreciate that very much. I've been thinking this week about a certain verse, and it just happens to be a verse that the One Cry prayer team is working over this year. If you remember, One Cry was a Bible study and a revival study that we went through when Steve and I first came, which has been 6 years ago already. Hard to believe, but that is still a revival and a prayer meeting that meets weekly online, and the prayer calendars are typically out for you to take. But the verses that they're studying through this summer is from Isaiah 64, and it ties in with our opening hymn today, just the opening part of that passage. And it comes with a desire to see the kingdom come. And the writer says, "Oh, that you would rend the heavens and come down, that the mountains might quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood, and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to your adversaries, that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome things that we did not look for, you came down. The mountains quaked at your presence. From of old, no one has heard or perceived by the ear. No eye has seen a God besides you who acts for those who wait on him." Isn't that glorious to have that desire that the heavens would open and that we would see the kingdom of God together as a church family and as a nation and as our world? So as we sing this morning, "Come, Thou Almighty King," let that be our prayer, that the kingdom would come and that we would see the King for who he is. I invite you to stand and sing number 61. This is "Come, Thou Almighty King." Our scripture lesson today comes from Paul's second letter to the Corinthians. This is chapter 11, verses 1 through 15. 2 Corinthians 11, 1 through 15. "I wish you would bear with me in a little foolishness." Oh, do bear with me. "For I feel a divine jealousy for you, since I betrothed you to one husband to present you as a pure virgin to Christ. But I am afraid that as the serpent deceived Eve by his cunning, your thoughts will be led astray from a sincere and pure devotion to Christ. For if someone comes and proclaims another Jesus than the one we proclaimed, or if you receive a different spirit from the one you received, or if you accept a different gospel from the one you accepted, you put up with it readily enough. Indeed, I consider that I am not in the least inferior to these super apostles. Even if I am unskilled in speaking, I am not so in knowledge. Indeed, in every way we have made this plain to you in all things. Or did I commit a sin in humbling myself so that you might be exalted, because I preached God's gospel to you free of charge? I robbed other churches by accepting support from them in order to serve you. And when I was with you and was in need, I did not burden anyone, for the brothers who came from Macedonia supplied my need. So I refrained and will refrain from burdening you in any way. As the truth of Christ is in me, this boasting of mine will not be silenced in the regions of Achaia. And why? Because I do not love you? God knows I do. And what I am doing, I will continue to do in order to undermine the claim of those who would like to claim that in their boasted mission they work on the same terms as we do. For such men are false apostles, deceitful workmen, disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. So it is no surprise if his servants also disguise themselves as servants of righteousness. Their end will correspond to their deeds. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Propaganda has always been an integral part of warfare. The point of propaganda is spread misleading or outright false information so that it will begin to demoralize the enemy. They try to convince the enemy that they cannot win. The goal is to get them to give up. Effective propaganda can be as destructive as guns and bombs. And it's more insidious because we can't see the destruction of propaganda. We can see the destruction of the guns and bombs. Now, by its very nature, spiritual warfare does not involve physical weapons. You don't see guns and bombs in spiritual warfare. They might be residual things. But they're not the primary weapons that are used. The weapons used in spiritual warfare are words and concepts, ideas and ideals. Spiritual warfare is primarily a propaganda war. That makes spiritual warfare more insidious indeed than physical warfare. In physical warfare, as I mentioned earlier, you can see the guns and bombs and the destruction they cause, but you don't see, at least not right away, the destruction caused by spiritual warfare. Satan is the master of propaganda. In the first sermon of this series, we saw that Satan fired the first shots in spiritual warfare. Remember back in the very first book of the Bible, in the third chapter, the serpent comes and entices Eve. He plants doubts in Eve's mind. It says that God is holding out against you, keeping the best things away from you. He used lies and misinformation to get Eve to doubt God's goodness and his provision. And so, she gave in. She took a bite out of the fruit from the tree that God had told both her and Adam not to eat from. And we have experienced the destructive effects ever since. This morning, we want to examine 2 Corinthians 11, 1 through 15, to see how the subtle and insidious spiritual propaganda is used against us. The Apostle Paul issues an indirect warning to us in this passage. His primary thing is trying to defend his ministry against people who are trying to undermine it. But in so doing, he begins to show us how spiritual propaganda works, what Satan is up to, and that Satan uses people, human beings, to either purposely or unwittingly spread misinformation and lies to obscure the truth. To fall for the deception will eventually lead to the destruction of our souls. So it's very important to be able to see, to be able to understand how Satan uses this propaganda, this deceit, in order to divert us from the true gospel. Now, it's important to understand the context of this portion of Scripture to understand what's at stake here, not only for the Corinthian church, but for us as well. Apparently, Hebrew teachers, who call themselves apostles of Christ, came to Corinth and began to try to undermine Paul's ministry. They asserted that Paul was inferior to them, that Paul could write impressive letters, but he couldn't speak very well. And he wasn't really a true apostle, because true apostles received money from those that they were ministering to. And so he was not receiving their support. He was not really an apostle, or at least an inferior apostle. Because these apostles received the money from the Corinthians, and they were eloquent speakers. You might say that they could sell pork chops to a vegetarian. They were good. As they were so good that the Corinthians were beginning to fall for their message. This portion of Paul's letter is a defense of his ministry to the Corinthians, and an indirect critique of these super apostles, as he facetiously refers to them. Now, in verses 2 through 4, Paul sets the integrity of his ministry against the deceit, the insincerity of the ministry of the super apostles. Paul writes, "For I feel a divine jealousy for you, since I betrothed you to one husband to present you as a pure virgin to Christ." The symbolism is important here. Marriage, throughout the New Testament, is often used as a metaphor for Christ's relationship with the church. And so it's very important. Jesus is the bridegroom, and the church is the bride. That's how it works out throughout the New Testament. And notice here that Paul says that he has a divine or godly jealousy for the Corinthians. Not of the Corinthians, but for the Corinthians. Now, you know, we tend to think of jealousy as a negative emotion, and it certainly can be. But it can be understood as positive. So to be jealous of someone's possessions is a bad thing. God once warns us not to be jealous in this sense. But to be jealous for someone's integrity or reputation is a good thing. It's a zeal that is good to have. So you might put it this way: if I'm jealous of another man because his wife looks good to me and he's the lucky stiff, I should have her. That's bad. That's bad jealousy. On the other hand, if someone is desiring my wife, and I'm jealous for her and for her affection because she is my wife, that is a good thing. Because how honored would my wife feel if I said, oh, well, I can always get another. No, she wants me to be jealous for her, to desire her, to defend her against other people who want to steal her. So Paul has a godly jealousy for the Corinthians. These other apostles are coming in, trying to steal them away from their husband, Jesus. They're planting thoughts in their minds. He cares about their integrity and their devotion to Christ. Since he says he is the one who betrothed them to Christ, and so somehow he is responsible to present them as holy and pure to Christ on the day of the consummation of the marriage. Because right now they're just betrothed. But someday the marriage will be consummated when he returns for them. Now, we 21st century Christians or Westerners don't really understand betrothal. Betrothal is really foreign to us. In our culture, couples get engaged, right? An engagement, it's important, it's a big deal, but they're really non-binding agreements. Yeah, to break off an engagement really has no legal or moral implications. You know, after a period of engagement, you say, well, you know, it's just not working out, it doesn't look good, so, you know, let's just go our separate ways. There's no problem with that. It may be an emotional cost to it, but it's not legal or moral. But betrothal was different. Now, like engagement, it was legally binding. Once you were betrothed to someone, you were as good as married. You weren't actually married. The marriage wasn't consummated, but you were tied to that person. One couldn't break off a betrothal just like that. They had to go through divorce proceedings. You had to get a legal divorce in order to break off a betrothal. And so, in using this metaphor, Paul is referring to himself really as the father of this church, who has pledged his daughter, the Corinthians, in marriage to a prospective husband, who is Jesus. And so he feels this responsibility. He said, I got to present you to your future husband as one, as somebody who is pure, who is spotless, and ready to consummate this marriage. And Paul takes this responsibility seriously. He has taught them the truth about Christ. He has taught them the truth about the gospel. He's been very careful about that. The one Christ, as preached by Paul, was and is to remain the focus of ministry and faith. But in verse 3, Paul expresses his fear that as the serpent deceived Eve by his cunning, so the Corinthians are being deceived and their thoughts will be led astray from a sincere and pure devotion to Christ. And this dangerous deception is being perpetrated by these super apostles, whom he also calls false apostles later on. Now, verse 4 indicates that these false apostles are deceiving the Corinthians in three ways. There are three ways that the Corinthians are in danger of being deceived. First, these apostles are proclaiming another Jesus than the one Paul proclaimed to them. As directed by God, Paul proclaimed Jesus Christ as the Son of God, incarnate. He was crucified to atone for our sins. He died, he was buried, he rose again. He was vindicated, and he was shown to have power over sin and death. and he ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. That's the Jesus that he presented. So what was the other Jesus? What other Jesus is there that these super apostles, these false apostles, are proclaiming? Well, it appears that these Hebrew false apostles were emphasizing his humanity, Jesus' humanity, at the expense of his divinity and his risen lordship. They were preaching the Jewishness of Jesus. They were preaching that he was a rabbi, perhaps pointing to his adherence to the law of Moses and denying his work as the Savior from sin. So they separated Jesus, the human being, from Jesus, the Son of God. They didn't recognize that part. And Paul was pressing the point that it matters what Jesus you believe in. It simply matters. If you believe in a false Jesus and the wrong Jesus, it's not helping you. You are not being saved. And that's important for us to remember today. Because if you haven't noticed, we have many false prophets. And they have infiltrated the church. And they're proclaiming another Jesus. A Jesus very different from the Gospels that you see and from the rest of the New Testament. Generally, I try to make the case that the Bible doesn't really give us a picture of the real Jesus. I said, hey, you know, the Bible was written by people who created these legends and these myths about Jesus. He performed all these miracles. No, he didn't. They made that up. They wanted to have this grand Jesus that would control people. And so we have in the Bible these myths and legends. And what we really need to do is get to the root of who Jesus really was, the historical Jesus. You may have heard that term, the historical Jesus. And what they mean by that is that we need to peel away all of the myths and the legends that have accumulated about Jesus and get back to who he really was. And in their minds, he was a man, not the Son of God. He was a Jewish rabbi, taught some really good things. We would do well to follow his example. But he really wasn't the Son of God. In fact, he died tragically. He died before he could accomplish his mission, which was really to spread goodwill everywhere. And so we have some examples, good examples in the Bible to follow, but this is not the Son of God who died for our sins. But I have to tell you that the belief in this so-called historic Jesus doesn't do us any good. To believe in someone who died and is still dead is not going to help us. We're still dead in our sins. And to believe in this historic Jesus as presented by these false apostles is extremely dangerous to our souls. The second way in which the Corinthians were being deceived by these false apostles is that they were receiving a different spirit from the one they received as a result of Paul's preaching. This idea of a different spirit is probably to be taken ironically, because there is no different spirit. And I doubt if they were preaching anything about the spirit. They were Hebrews who were trying to push the Mosaic law, the Torah. The Bible teaches us that the Holy Spirit is given to those who respond to the preaching of Jesus Christ as the Son of God and receive him as their Lord and Savior. So that's the only way to receive the Holy Spirit. these false apostles are trying to get the Corinthians to follow the law, follow the Torah, be good religious people. And Paul's point is that one doesn't receive the Holy Spirit by following the Torah. You can't do that. So the Spirit isn't available to them. Now, the false apostles that have infiltrated the church today may not insist that we keep the Mosaic law, but they do insist that we keep their law. You see, they have a disdain for the Mosaic law because the Mosaic law teaches things that they don't want to acknowledge. And so they come up with their own humanistic laws that they have elevated to scriptural status. For instance, they insist that we practice justice as they define it. The Bible speaks a lot about justice. Fighting for justice is good, but their idea of justice, the things that they pile into this thing, this loaded word called justice, defends a lot of bad things, a lot of things that God is not pleased with. That kind of thinking leads us to the spirit of the age rather than this Holy Spirit that is available to us through Jesus Christ. So Paul says, beware. The third way in which the Corinthians are being deceived is that they were accepting a different gospel than the one they originally accepted. The gospel, in a nutshell, is this, that the Son of God took on flesh. He became incarnate, born of a virgin. He was crucified to atone for the sins of the world. He died, he was buried, and he rose again to show his power over sin and death. He ascended to heaven, seated at the right hand of God. He is reigning, he is ruling even now. And those who by faith trust in this Jesus as their Savior and Lord will be saved by grace from the wrath of God and will experience everlasting life, eternal life, eternal life of joy in God's presence. So what were the false apostles teaching? They're probably teaching that you had to follow the Torah. The only way that you were going to be saved was to keep the law. And again, we have counterparts to these false teachers today. The false teachers today proclaim that if you practice justice and righteousness as they define justice and righteousness, you'll be saved. You're a good person, so you'll get to heaven, whatever that means. If you devote yourself to the right causes, if you conform to the patterns that they set forth, then you will be saved. Whatever it means to be saved. The false apostles tried to enhance their deceitful schemes by elevating themselves and diminishing Paul. So they eloquently presented their case, and some of the Corinthians at least fell under their spell. These false apostles insisted that to be a real apostle, Paul had to accept the patronage of the people to whom he was ministering. They wanted to feel a part of his ministry, and so they saw it as a privilege to support him. And Paul didn't do that. He answers that critique by saying that he offered the gospel free of charge so that he wouldn't be a burden on them. Other people were supporting him, so he didn't need their money. He did not apologize for not taking their money. Now, the other charge against Paul is that he wasn't a very good speaker. As a writer, he could talk big, but as a speaker, he wasn't very impressive. I don't know, maybe people were yawning when they were listening to him. Now, he may not have been as eloquent a speaker as the other super apostles, but he was not inferior to them. He says, I'm not inferior to them in knowledge. So I know more than they do. After all, eloquently proclaimed falsehood is still falsehood. It's not true. And no matter how eloquently you express it, it's not going to make it true. Paul knew that he was writing and speaking what God was directing him to write and speak. And some of his letters, including the one that we're looking at today, is part of Scripture. It is part of the Bible. We don't see any of the super apostles in the Bible. So Paul was preaching and writing from the direction, the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. Now today we have false teachers who dismiss Paul as well, as someone who simply spewed his own theology and his own opinions. Many people today grant Paul no authority or weight. They don't look at his letters on the same level as the Gospels, because, of course, the Gospels have the very words of Jesus. So they say. But God's word encompasses everything, the Old and the New Testaments, the Gospels, the letters, the Apocalypse, everything. And so when we read Paul in the Bible, those words are God's words. As Paul says in verse 10, the truth of Christ is in him. Now in verses 12 through 15, Paul evaluates these false apostles, and he comes to a chilling conclusion. Starting in verse 12, he writes, and what I am doing, I will continue to do in order to undermine the claim of those who would like to claim that in their boasted mission, they work on the same terms as we do. So Paul is determined to expose these false apostles. He's telling the Corinthians, wake up. Look at what they're trying to do. He doesn't want them to get away with the claim that they are on the same level as Paul. He doesn't want them to get to that level, not because he's jealous of them, but because he doesn't want them to have that status to pull people away from the true gospel. Paul continues in verse 13, for such men are false apostles, deceitful workmen, disguising themselves as apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light. So it is no surprise if his servants also disguise themselves as servants of righteousness. And here's the chilling part. Their end will correspond to their deeds. Paul pulls no punches. He doesn't try to sugarcoat the situation. It's too important. The deceit that these super apostles, these false apostles, are spreading is dangerous. It's dangerous to our souls. These men are false apostles, deceitful workmen. They may look and talk like apostles of Christ, but it is a disguise. They are wolves in sheep's clothing. And most shocking of all, Paul calls these men servants of Satan. Now let's give them the benefit of the doubt. There are a lot of people that you could say they're servants of Satan, but they're not doing it purposely. They don't worship Satan. They don't intentionally follow Satan. But what they're doing is actually serving Satan's purposes. Satan is a liar. He wants to spread lies, and so he does that through some well-meaning people. And so we can call people servants of Satan, even though they may be doing it unwittingly. But the chilling thing is that their deceit will eventually contribute to their ruin. Because as they serve Satan, they will receive the same sentence as Satan. And as we'll see in the last installment of this series, where Satan is going is the pit, everlasting separation from God. So the warning is clear. We must be on guard for the dangerous deception of the enemy of our souls. We must discern the spirits. Spiritual warfare is like guerrilla warfare. You don't know where the next attack is coming from. Satan will issue his propaganda through the eloquent lips of people who are trying to deceive you. They have their agendas. And their agendas don't include speaking the truth of God's word. These people will look and sound like compassionate pastors and knowledgeable theologians. And so because they have the title, we trust them. Their words will sound true and reasonable. But beware. Not all that sounds good is good. Test what you hear through Scripture. Know the Scriptures. See the Scriptures. Put them up against what these apostles, these teachers are preaching. Set the Scriptures against what I'm preaching. Don't take it for granted. Don't let anyone cause you to be diverted from a pure devotion to the one true Christ. The stakes are too high. Don't fall for Satan's lies. Don't fall victim to the dangerous deception of his servants. Your eternal destiny is at stake. You must believe and follow the truth. Let's pray. Well, Father, we desperately desire to know the truth. We have lies all around us. The world is trying to tug us to follow its agenda. It wants to have us leap on every new cause and every ideal. And this kind of deception is infiltrating the church. Very eloquent speakers and writers are telling us lies. And it's so easy to fall for it. So I pray, Lord, that you will help us to be grounded in the scriptures, to know your word, so that we can stand against those lies, that we will not be deceived. Father, help us to strap on our spiritual armor and take that sword of the Spirit, your word, into our hands and slice through the deception. Oh Lord, it is only through your power, through your greatness, your goodness, your knowledge, your wisdom, that we ever hope to get past those lies. So help us. Don't let us try to stand against Satan's schemes by ourselves. Pray this in Jesus' name. And in his name, we pray the prayer that he taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
I feel a tug this morning that as a church body, we should together, in spite of what is going on around us, proclaim the faith that we believe. So this is an audible from the PowerPoint, but if you would open your hymnals to number 880, this is the Nicene Creed, one of the first creeds that came out in the early church to stand for what the gospel that we have heard, the gospel that we proclaim, and the gospel that we believe. If we could stand and recite that together with our whole hearts, what we believe. This is number 880, the Nicene Creed, and then we will lead into our final hymn. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who is with the Father and the Son, is worshiped and glorified, who was spoken through the prophets. We believe in the one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Thank you. That is powerful, especially when spoken together. In trying to find hymns for spiritual warfare and deception, there are not many in the hymnal that fall under that category. But this one, I think, came from John chapter 10, where Jesus said, "My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." So as we navigate the waters of warfare and the pitfalls of spiritual deception, if we are listening to Jesus' voice and he is leading us like our shepherd, we shall be safe. This is number 381, Savior, like a shepherd, lead us.
Lord bless you and keep you. Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.